I have to admit that glucocorticoids are amongst my favorite medications that we regularly use in the intensive care unit. Whether it be, say, hydrocortisone, dexamethasone, methylprednisolone, I have these particular medications under their specific indications built into my EMR as order set. Today, I'm going to be discussing an article that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine in March of 2023. It is titled, Hydrocortisone in Severe Community-Acquired Pneumonia. As I always state, read these data for yourself as this is not medical advice and you should not trust somebody who's on the internet. First question is, why do we care? Well, it turns out that community-acquired pneumonia is the number 9 cause of death in the United States and the number 1 cause of infectious death. Patients who end up on invasive mechanical ventilation due to community-acquired pneumonia have a mortality rate of 30%. And here's the kicker behind that. This is in the United States where we have all the fancy medications, antibiotics, ventilators, lots of intensivists, lots of ICU beds, and the mortality rate is still, unfortunately, around 30%. This is the reason why looking at treatments such as hydrocortisone and other glucocorticoids to try to make these common illnesses have a decreased mortality is because at the end of the day, even though we have all these fancy treatments in the United States, it turns out that the rest of the world is not necessarily as fortunate as we are. And we have to think about inexpensive, readily available medications that could potentially help save lives in other parts of the world. Let's look at the history of glucocorticoids for other ailments. Over the several years that I've been creating content for my social media accounts, for my podcast, for my website, for my YouTube channel, I've covered the utilization of glucocorticoids for a number of different ailments. These ailments include now talking about ACLS by using methylprednisolone during code blues. We know about it during the last 2 years and what's happened there. There's now data supporting the utilization of corticosteroids in ARDS. And now there's also data for the utilization of glucocorticoids in patients with community-acquired pneumonia. The next question is, which subset of community-acquired pneumonia patients were enrolled into this clinical trial? Here, the authors created a randomized double-blind superiority trial. Hat tip to the authors, and always read these data for yourself. Out of all different types of community-acquired pneumonia, what they did is that they took the subset of patients who had severe community-acquired pneumonia and randomized them to either receive the hydrocortisone or receive placebo. How they defined the community-acquired pneumonia was of special interest to me because we in the ICU only take care of the sickest of the sick, and we want to know if it'll help out our particular patient population. In order to be enrolled into the study under the severe category, the patients needed to have one of 4 characteristics. Either they were on invasive mechanical ventilation, they were on non-invasive ventilation, which many people call BiPAP, on high-flow nasal cannula or non-rebreather, and number 4 is that they had to have a pneumonia severity index of greater than 130. To be honest with you, I was very rusty as to what the pneumonia severity index was, so I had to look it up myself because that's not something I use every day in my practice. They were going to try to enroll 800 patients into this clinical trial, but spoiler alert, the trial was stopped early because they found a benefit for these patients. Next up, let's talk about the dosing of the hydrocortisone in this clinical trial. These patients received 200 milligrams of IV hydrocortisone daily for the first 4 days. Interesting to note that they received it as a continuous infusion. As a point of reference, when we provide hydrocortisone for stress dose steroids for patients who are in septic shock, we either use 50 milligrams of hydrocortisone IV every 6 hours, or we use 100 milligrams IV every 8 hours. As of late, I'm ordering the 100 milligrams IV Q8 hours in my practice because this is fewer times that the nurse has to go in there to change bags. On day 4 of administration of the hydrocortisone, the team decided whether to continue giving the steroids for 8 days or extend it up to 14 days. Eventually, the hydrocortisone was tapered off, not stopped cold turkey. Let's look at the primary outcomes now. The primary outcome was defined as death by any cause whatsoever by day 28. In the group that received hydrocortisone, 6.2% of patients died. In the control group, however, 11.9% of patients passed away. Considering that I mentioned earlier that the literature shows a 30% mortality in patients with community-acquired pneumonia who get sick enough to end up in the ICU, well, the fact that this was less than 12% of patients, even in the control group, means that overall these patients did pretty well. When I looked further into this particular study, one would notice that patients who were in septic shock were excluded from this trial, which is why the mortality levels are so low. If you plug in these numbers into your nifty number needed to treat calculator, you'll find out that the number needed to treat is just 17.5, which is not the best we've ever seen, but at the same time, not bad when it comes to a medication that's so inexpensive as well as readily available. Next up, let's talk about the secondary outcomes. And here, the secondary outcomes were plentiful and they were almost all statistically significant, showing a benefit to the utilization of hydrocortisone in patients with community-acquired pneumonia. Death at day 90 was 9.3% versus 14.7% in the control group. This slightly inflated the number needed to treat up to 18.5. Another benefit is that fewer patients who received hydrocortisone were intubated compared to those in the control group. This is possibly my favorite part of this trial because it tells us as clinicians that we should go ahead and initiate the hydrocortisone prior to the patient ending up with a breathing tube, ending up on mechanical ventilation. When you take a look at the number needed to treat to avoid endotracheal tube placement and mechanical ventilation, here that number was just 8.7. And to be quite frank with you, I love single digit number needed to treats. The hydrocortisone also helped patients not go into septic shock. And the number needed to treat to find that benefit was just 10.3. So all good things from the secondary outcomes. I know that we have a lot of criticisms about secondary outcomes, that they're hypothesis generating, etc. But in this case, I see them as pluses because at the end of the day, this trial was stopped early because they found so much benefit. Now we have to look at the adverse effects of using hydrocortisone in community-acquired pneumonia. And here, what the authors found should be no surprise to us. Hyperglycemia was found in these patient populations. But here's my rebuttal to hyperglycemia. We have insulin for that. So if your patient is becoming hyperglycemic, we have insulin to try to get that under control. Other things that people are usually concerned about when providing glucocorticoids for sepsis, ARDS, etc., are secondary infections, GI bleeds, psychosis, etc. And just like these haven't been necessarily found in the larger studies, this was also not found in this particular clinical trial. Should we be changing our practice and administering glucocorticoids to patients who have severe community-acquired pneumonia? My answer is yes, we should be doing that. Although that is my opinion, that's not medical advice. You do whatever you think you should do when you read these data. We've already seen a number of different scenarios where we've had good outcomes with the utilization of glucocorticoids, and now community-acquired pneumonia could be added to septic shock, could be also added to ARDS, and other different things, different clinical scenarios that we often run into in the ICU where we could help save patients' lives. Let me know what you think if you're going to change your practice in the comment section below. I'd also greatly appreciate it. If you're new to the channel and you haven't subscribed, please go ahead and do so. Also leave a thumbs up if I taught you absolutely anything because that helps the channel grow. Have a great day, guys. Bye.